हेलो एवरीवन, ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड एनालिसिस एंड डिजाइन लैंग्वेज वी हैव टू सी द इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट द ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड एनालिसिस एंड द डिजाइन. सो इन दिस ऑब्जेक्ट ओरिएंटेड एनालिसिस डिजाइन वी हैव टू नो पर्टिकुलरली द सिस्टम सब सिस्टम मॉडल एंड डायग्राम. First of all, we have to see about all these things. After that, we will move to available diagrams in the object-oriented analysis and design. Right? System. System. What is a system? System is a collection of subsystems. System is a collection of subsystems. System is a collection of subsystems organized for a purpose and described by a set of models. System contains subsystems which is used to organize, organizing for a purpose, organizing for a purpose and describing a set of models. In subsystem, grouping of elements showing the part behavior of the system. What is the subsystem contains? Subsystem contains part behavior of the system. Part behavior of the system. Actually, system contains different modules. In subsystem, we are contain part behavior of the system. What is a model? Model is a semantically closed abstraction of the system. Semantically closed abstraction of the system. That is, represents a complete and self-consistent simplification of reality. What is a model? Model can tell that the real world problem is there. Real world problem is there. That real world problem will be translated into diagrammatical representation, simply called as a model. Model is a blueprint of the real world problem, a real world problem, blueprint of the real world problem, model. Next, diagram. We want to know about the diagram. Diagram, what is a diagram? Diagram is a graphical representation of a set of elements. What is a diagram? Diagram is a graphical representation of set of elements, most often rendered as connected graph. Connected graph, connected graph, diagram. So, in this diagram, we have things and relationship. For every diagram, we observe things and relationship there. Okay? So, diagram is a graphical representation of the elements or the things or the relationships, the combiningly we are talking about the diagram. Okay, so you observe the system is in real world problem, system will be designing for a purpose and subsystem contain a part behavior of the system and also model is the blueprint of the system, real world problem. Diagram is the pictorial representation of the particular system. You have to remember or you have to understand. After understanding all these, we have to know what is going on in the next. Okay. Next, UML diagrams. Unified Modeling Language Diagrams uses. Unified Modeling Language Diagram uses two kind of diagrams. Two categories of the diagrams. First category is static diagram and the second category is dynamic diagram. First category is static. Static diagram is simply called as a structural diagram, whereas second one is the behavioral diagram, that is simply called as dynamic diagrams. Two categories of the diagrams are there. Static diagrams will represent the skeleton of the project. Skeleton of the system. Static diagram representing skeleton of the system that will gives only the structure of the system. Static diagrams are of four diagrams. First one is a class diagram. Class diagram is belongs to static diagram. Object diagram and component diagram, deployment diagram. All of the diagrams belongs to static diagrams. The other name of static diagram is structural diagrams. Structural diagrams. Class diagram, object diagram, component diagram and deployment diagram. all these static diagrams representing the blueprints of the system, blueprints, only structural view of the system. Okay, so see, additional diagrams are there, that is dynamic diagrams, additional diagrams. Dynamic diagrams are the diagrams. In dynamic diagrams, five diagrams are there, five diagrams are there. First one, use case diagram. Second one, sequence diagram, collaboration diagram, state chart diagram, and activity diagram. Combiningly, we have to take static diagrams and dynamic diagrams, we simply called as a UML diagrams. If you want to develop a system, if you want to develop a system, whatever the system you can create, that is library management system, or airline reservation system, or railway reservation system, ATM, automatic teller machine system, whatever the system you are designing, you have to understand the structural part of the UML and also the behavioral part of the UML, which shows you completely draw all these diagrams for a particular system, right? The UML defines these nine kind of diagrams. These nine kind of diagrams you can use to develop one system, completely system. Next, structural diagrams, I said already. The UML's four structural diagrams exist: the visualize the system, and specifying the system, and constructing the system, and documenting the system. Visualize, specify, construct, document the system. Those are only shows the static parts of the system. Static parts of the system. The static aspects of the system represents skeleton of the system, which shows the skeleton of the system. The UML structural diagrams are roughly organized around the major group, the things you will find when the modeling the system. There you can find class diagram contain classes, interfaces, and collaborations. Object diagram contains objects. Class diagrams contain classes, interfaces, collaborations. Object diagram contain objects. Component diagram contain components. Deployment diagram contain nodes. We have to see each and every diagram in our whole syllabus. In our 6 units of syllabus, we are going to learn all these 9 diagrams completely, and we have to draw all these 9 diagrams for a particular system. Okay? In our lab programs, we are having 12 exercises. 12 exercises are there, 12 problems is there. For all the 12 problems, we have to draw all the 9 diagrams. Okay? So these are the static aspects. What is the behavioral aspects? That is the dynamic aspects of the system. Dynamic aspects of the system. So the UML's five behavioral diagrams are used to visualize, specify, construct, and also document. If you have static diagrams, all static diagrams also visualize, construct, document, and specifying the system. The dynamic diagrams is also used to visualize, construct, document, and specify the particular system. Complete view of the system also dynamic diagrams also give us, right? So you can think of that dynamic aspects of the system is the use case diagram, sequence diagram, collaboration diagram, state chart diagram, activity diagram. The diagrams which are having dynamic aspects of the behavior, the diagrams which are telling the behavior of the particular system. So the behavior, in the sense, if I give input to the particular system, what is going on to the next? What is going on to the, after giving the input to that particular position or the situation, if you give the input to that particular system, where it goes, what is the response of that particular system? The complete behavior will be available with the help of these dynamic systems. Okay, so we have to learn each and every one. First diagram, class diagram. Class diagram, we seen in the last video, what is a class diagram? What are the parts available in the classroom? That is, how many parts the class diagram will be divided? name of the class, attributes of the class, methods of the class, that is operations of the class, and other one is the responsibilities of the class. All other things are there. How do we create a name, how do we create attributes, we are all seen in the last class. Now we have to know about that class diagram. Class diagram. What is a class diagram? A class diagram shows a set of classes, interfaces and collaborations and their relationships. So where to see what a class diagram contains? Classes, interfaces means the software components. Interfaces means the software components which are also created and attached to the interfaces. And collaborations. Collaboration means combiningly adding the many number of operations together. We represent collaboration. Dotted circle, dotted ellipse is the collaboration symbol. Relationships, we know the relationships of class diagram are of three or four kinds. Dependency relationship, second one is the generalization relationship, third one is the association relationship. In association we are also having aggregation relationship and also another relationship is there. Realization relationship, another one, additional relationship system. So see, most common diagram found in modeling object oriented system, class diagram is the most commonly static diagram. Used to illustrate static design view. Why do we draw the class diagram static design view, which represents static design view? Class diagrams that include active classes used to address the static process view. Class diagram is also having some active classes is also there. Active classes. What kind of the class is going to be executed at particular time? Activately, which will follow different kind of operations. See, these are all having in the class diagram. In object diagram, second one is object. Object diagram. What is object diagram? Object diagram shows the set of objects and their relationships. Relationships contain collaborations, links. In object diagram contain collaborations and links are the relationships and also which have objects, which include objects also. Object diagram addresses the static design view. This object diagram is also representing the static design view or static process view. A system just as do class diagrams. Object diagram is also like how the system will be executing in class diagram. The simple class diagram like also object diagram will be represented. Next, object oriented analysis and design. Actually, what is our syllabus? In second unit syllabus. See, classes and objects, second unit complete syllabus is classes and object. Nature of the object, nature of the object representing what is an object, how do we create an object. Relationships among the objects, relationships among the objects, two relationships are there, link relationships and also collaborated relationships, collaboration relationships. Nature of the class also, what is a nature of the class, how do we having the class structure, that is also available, and interplay of classes and objects. Now we have to see the interplay of the classes and objects. Interplay of the classes and objects means that what is the relationship between the object and the class. The most often you have to see the interplay of the class and objects. Relationship between the classes and object. Interplay in the sense relationship between the classes and object. Most often every object is the instance of some class. We know every object is the instance of some class. Every class has a zero instances or the more instances. Instances, more objects. Zero objects are the more objects. So the class of most objects is static. What is the meaning of particular the conclusion? The most of the objects created for a particular class diagram is static object. Meaning that once an object is created, if an object is created, its class is already fixed. An object is created, its class is already fixed. If you see the relationship between the classes and object, the relationship between the classes and object is said that. So, for example, in airline system, runways are there, planes are there, and takeoff and using the runways every time. So, if an airline system uses to give one airline system at one particular time of one flight, so that flight will be using only that flight, that is airline system. Simply say that runway, whatever the runway you give to a particular plane, so that plane should be used that runway only. Whenever that plane is take off, after that this runway will used by another plane. So exactly no two planes are using same runway. That means no two objects are using the same property, same name of the particular objects. Okay. And next, role of classes and objects in analysis and design. What is the role of classes and objects? Role of the classes and objects, we have to identify the classes. First thing is identification of the classes. Identify the classes and objects that form the vocabulary of the system, that is simply known as key abstractions. Finding the objects and the classes is the key abstractions. Invent the structure, whether the sets of objects work together to provide the behavior that satisfy the requirements of the problem. Those are simply called as the mechanisms. First of all, identify the classes and objects, and then identify the behavior of the particular object or the class. So you identify the behavior and identifying the actual vocabulary of the particular problem. So that's simply taking the key abstractions and also the mechanisms. Identifying is nothing but the key abstractions of classes and objects. And next, mechanisms, in the sense how those classes are acting or how those objects are acting. We completely see those information with the help of these two mechanics. This is simply called as role of classes and objects. See here, there is no particular method, there is no particular theory to identify the classes or to identify the objects. Again, I am repeating, no particular method is there to identify. Just vocabulary of the particular system you have to find. Among that system, you have to identify, or you have to think that system should have some these kind of classes. You have to think. If I give same system to the another developer, they may have different kind of objects. They may have to find different kind of classes also. Not in the same classes, same number of classes or same number of objects. The main reason is to find classes and objects, no method is there. We have to establish, we have to think our mind. That is the classification. Right. So here, that is the classes and objects and importance of proper classification. What is an important of proper classification? See, importance of proper classification is, classification is the means whereby we order the knowledge. Depending upon the knowledge, you can have to create your own objects, have to create your own classes. Depending upon the knowledge, I can create for a system suppose I have to create a system, for example, library management system. In that system, I have to analyze 5 classes. If I give same problem to you, you may have different kind of classes, objects. Not the same set of classes, not the same set of objects. Depending upon the thinking capability, classification means whereby we ordering the knowledge, depending upon the, see, different kind of problems, different kind of animals are there. So you see, as your perspective, you can think your own way and to identify the classes and objects. No, don't worry, and no problems available. No problem. Now see, what is the importance of the classes? Different observers will classify the same object in different ways. I said, different observers will classify the same object in different ways. Depending upon the vocabulary of the particular system, you can think that otherwise, I can think other way, another person, third person think another way. So the completely different observers will classify the same object in different ways. So he is thinking that this object is like this, or this object is like this, or this object like this, this object like this. So everyone, different observers will be classifying the same object in different ways also. That may not be problem to identify the objects or classes. Okay, that is the most important thing in the classification. In the classification also, what is the major advantage of in the classification? Incremental and iterative nature of the classification. You may have to use the life cycle model, incremental and iterative process of the classes. First of all, you have to take the items, you have to plan the particular items. After planning the particular item, you have to collaborate those items. Those items will be daily reviewed depending upon the items. First of all, I created the items backlog items are easy like this. And after I changed while they give some feedback from the reviewers, I have to change this iteration. After that, I deliverable items are, first items are these. I am review these items. After reviewing these items, we are deliverable items are there. Again, incremental process will be taking day by day, or the iteration by iteration, you may have to increment. Iteration by iteration, you may have to increment the different levels of problem or the different levels of incremental nature of the particular items. Repeatedly collaborate these things and also deliver the particular things. So you have to use to classify a classes. If you develop a class, from that class, you can give to that class to the reviewer. He may give some suggestions. That suggestions will also add to your classes and objects. And then you can use that classes into a particular system. Likewise, you can use incremental way of each and every class. Incremental way of each and every classes. That is the most important thing we are having in classes and objects classification. So incremental way we have to use. Next, identifying classes and objects. I already said that identifying the classes and objects is very difficult situation. No method we are following to identify the classes and objects here. As you like, you can find a system, you can I give a system to you. From the document, you analyze suppose 10 classes I created. I gave same system to you. You may have 9 kind of classes, or you may have 12 or 15 kind of classes. Depending upon the thinking capability, you may have to define different classes. No need to worry. Why? Because class diagram or object diagram is only telling that the structural skeleton of the problem. Structural skeleton of the particular system. Okay? So, identification of the classes and objects. So, here we are having three kind of identification of classes and objects. So, first one is classical categorization. To identify classes and objects in modern approach. So, sometimes we may use classical categorization. What classical categorization will be having? This will have a property. Classical categorization will only depending upon the property. Categorize something. Suppose if you take a married or unmarried. So, the person will belongs to a married category or the unmarried category. In between those, a person should remain one. Either it is a married classification or it is a unmarried classification, simply called as categorize. So, that thinking is also important while you classical the modern approaches of a system. Okay. So, the classical approach uses property as the criteria for sameness among objects. Specifically, one can divide object into disjoint sets. Depending upon the presence of or absence of the particular property. Depending upon the property, we are classifying the categorization. The fact that bird can fly. Flying is the property for the bird. The bird can fly, but the fish cannot. See, classical and modern approach, another one is conceptual clustering. Classical categorization, conceptual clustering. It's closely related to fuzzy multi-values theory. In conceptual clustering, using fuzzy multi-value theory, set theory. So, which objects may belong to one or more groups and varying degree of fitness. Conceptual clustering makes absolute judgment classification by focusing the best fit of the fitness clustering, fuzzy value, multi-value related. You can take concept. Depending upon the concept, they have to divide classes into different ways or objects into different ways. Class love song, for example, that is one concept, love song. That love song, divide different love songs into one concept. Likewise, concept wise, you can divide the classes or objects. Next one, prototype theory. Third one is the prototype. A class object is represented by a prototypical object, and an object is considered to be a member of this class if and only if remains this prototype is significant. Here, in conceptual clustering, we group things according to the distinct concepts. Prototypical theory, we group the things in distinct ways. So, the prototype theory, we go through grouping the things. We group the things according to the degree of their relationships to concrete prototypes. Different prototypes, depending on the degree of the prototype, the theory will remain giving us to establish a different kind of classes and the object. Okay. So, these are all the important classifications in this theory. So, if you see the key abstractions and mechanisms, key abstractions in the sense you have to see finding the classes and objects, and mechanisms is like that. No mechanisms here we are following, but vocabulary, based on the vocabulary, we have to see, we have to find the system, classes and objects. Okay. So, here, summary. In this class, we learnt about the interplay of classes and objects, interrelationship of classes and objects, and what are the classification rules, why do we use classification. Okay, so with this class we conclude this one. We have to know the other things in other class. Thank you.